Please put your hands together for none other than Sanjay Puri from Sanjay Puri Architects, Mumbai.
So anyway, while the lights were going off, you know, yesterday I was at this event of Construction Week Awards on a panel discussion, and the question asked to me was that there is a lot of this small affordable housing being built and everything is selling when it is being advertised in the nascent stages. But once the buildings are completed, people go and find the rooms too small. They find toilets which are not ventilated, and then they move out and they don't want to live there anymore. And the question asked to me was, what do you think of this? So my reply was that forget affordable housing. In the last 5 years, the number of towers that have come up, towers, supposedly luxury towers by international firms, very, very expensive, upwards of 7 crores. I know people who have gone in, looked at the apartment after it was complete, and said, we cannot live here, so we're going to rather rent this place. And the reason is, all toilets, no natural ventilation. In some cases, curtain wall buildings, residential towers, 40, 50, 60 stories, curtain wall, the opening of a window is less than, what, 20%. Kitchens have no ventilation. Corridors have no ventilation. And all this is in India where there's enough sunlight. So why? So it's this whole thing about trying to create contextual design. And I remember 5 years back, somebody had asked that, you know, there was this other panel discussion going on where they said, what do you think of international firms coming in? You know, a lot of firms are coming in and a lot of you are going to lose your jobs or lose some projects at least. So what do you think we can do? I say, we don't need to do anything. Wait for 5 years, the results will show. And that's exactly what has happened. All those people who went and paid those astronomical figures, got those towers completed, have now all come back to Indian architects. It's a good thing for us. So Okay, the first project I'm showing you is called Ishatam 9. It's a 16-storied building in Ranchi. And this is the site and the actual views of the site. So it's very important to understand what you're building and for who you're building. Ranchi is a very small city. And like most Indian small cities, everybody was used to living in a bungalow or in a small villa or in a row house. They were able to walk out of their house into a garden or an open space, which is immediate. And what happened with the advent of, you know, real estate prices going up, land scarcity, where people are forced to start building high-rise buildings. Unlike Delhi and Bombay, which have some amount of land where they can go and expand, or Nagpur or Indore, all these cities have had spaces to expand all around. Bombay only vertically, but places like Delhi all around. Ranchi, on the other hand, is landlocked with Adivasi land all around where you cannot build. So land prices in Ranchi over the same one decade have gone up by 40 times. So obviously families who were living in bungalows and villas, families have grown bigger. They need larger houses or they need more apartments, or the son has grown up, got married, daughter's grown up, got married, need a house. They can't afford a bungalow anymore, so they have to go to an apartment. And what happened over the last 7-8 years, people started making these apartment buildings. The FSI has been brought up to 3 blanket all over Ranchi, not dependent on the road width, as is the case in most other cities, because the government realized that there is a scarcity. But then what happened in all these buildings is, you would expect that there is a shortage. But 5 years, 7 years down, there's nobody living in any of these apartments. or at least 50% of them are incomplete. So let's look at organic housing, how a ground plus one or a whole cluster of housing gave everybody their little open space. So today, because there is scarcity of land, we are forced to build a little higher. So why is it that we can't build that too in an organic way, giving everybody some amount of open space of their own? So this is what we try to do in this very small plot. We said, let's give every apartment, and not every apartment, every room of every apartment, a nice amount of open space which they can walk out to, so that the apartment does not feel like a box, which is what 95% of apartment buildings in India built over the last 10 years unfortunately feel like. So this is the floor plan. It's a very, very small site. In fact, it has a very narrow entry on the main road. And what we did is create, you know, two kinds of plans where balconies alternate. And it's a single apartment of floor, because the plinth area available itself after leaving the required open spaces were only 2,000 square feet. Now, ideally, the best kind of space that you could have outside an apartment would be a terrace space. Here, this is a cross section of the plan, and as it goes up, these balconies keep alternating. So this is the difference between a balcony and a terrace, which is of course evident to everybody here. A balcony is a completely sheltered space. So it's like a room not having a window on one side. It's balcony over balcony over balcony stack. So while it gives you a certain sense of openness, it is not the same amount of openness that a terrace, an open terrace, gives you. So the ideal kind of space to have would be a terrace. But if on this small plot, you were to start creating terraces, the building would have gone into the neighbor's plot, because that's the small size of the plot. So we obviously can't give open to sky terraces. So what is the next best thing? So we worked on this module. If we were to have open terraces, this is what would happen. The building would actually go out of the side. So this is what is done. The two opposite ends of the balconies are projected. And as a result of this, you give every individual in every room the option of whether you want to stand in the shade and be in a sheltered space like a balcony, or whether you want to stand in a portion that is open to sky. And that is what makes the difference. So within this small plot of only 1600 square meters, with a floor plate of only 2200 square feet, every apartment and every room in every apartment opens into a balcony of this shape. And that's the kind of feeling, and that's the kind of opportunity you give to each person. It's their choice. These are cross sections, very simple building, single basement, and the floor plans. And a lot of people who look at this building for the first time think this is a purely elevational thing, and wow, you create some different kind of module. But actually, that is the whole reason for doing it. You give every person the option of standing in the sun or standing in the shade, standing in the open under the stars, or being in the shelter, depending upon what time of the day it is. These are views from the other sides. And as you see it from the main road, behind a petrol pump, and that's the actual scale of the balconies which are outside the living room. Each one is 22 feet high. And of course, it creates an interesting sculptural composition as well. So that was the first person who moved into this house, and actually the comment that he gave me made the whole design worthwhile for doing it. He bought two apartments instead of one and connected them internally, and said that, you know, Sanjayji, I've been searching and searching in Ranchi for 4 years. I can't tell you how many apartments I've been to. I did not find a single one which made me feel like I was in the open. Everything felt like a closed in box, and I refused, and my family refused to move in. And finally, we found a place which is open enough and airy enough, and we moved in here. We have amazing views from this in every direction. And that was one of the other reasons that, you know, The client first said, why can't you make two small apartments? I told him that there's, you know, the need here is you have to understand that people are moving from private houses. It's not just about open space, but it's also that whole thing about wanting to be one, as in you don't share the lobby. So, of course, this was a small floor plate, so you could do it that way. And these are the detailed floor plans showing how every single room is cross-ventilated with the balconies turning around on all sides, each one rotating on the corners and alternating in the center. These are the studies that we did on the spatial daylight autonomy, which shows that 90% of the internal spaces have natural light. And actually, if you go to see, the other 10% are only the elevator shafts and the blue portion in the front, which is a void because the terrace is alternate. And the annual sun exposure, which indicates that there is no amount, no portion in this entire apartment which gets harsh sunlight. So, which means it's a very energy efficient building. The air conditioning cost required is much lower as compared to a normal building. These are construction photographs. The building has been made at a very low cost, about 1800 rupees a square foot, done by a local contractor who never done more than 4 stories in his life. And this again is a very important thing. You know, you cannot propose something which becomes unreasonable to be built. So this was done by a local Ranchi contractor. And the only thing is that we had to do a lot of supervision until he got the first centering right. And after that, it was easy. This is on-site work. So that was Ishatom 9. So the next project is Highway 27, which is in Gujarat. So this, the Gujarat government is creating this new highway, and all along the new highway, they want to build a series of small motels, just 5 to 6 rooms with a petrol pump and a restaurant. So that's the site plan. There are a number of sites marked for it, and they had a competition for this. So our site is in Disa. Very, very small location. That's the site. And behind this, there is a well on the southeast. So these are the hotels that have been coming up in India over the last few years. You know, every chain goes and makes its own hotel in its own prototype, and there is no cognizance of where you're building, what is the context. It's the same kind of box building that you would make in Europe or in the US. You're making the same thing in India. Repetition of square windows, one by one, all over them. This, of course, is a really small site, and it's also an earthquake free zone, which is very important. So we looked at the Bunny Village as a perfect example of how the circular form built with local materials is earthquake proof, and at the same time is very efficient in terms of cooling to the internal spaces. And we took a take on that, and from that derived the entire spaces program for this small site. So that's the existing pond at the back, and on the top is a cross section through the site. What we did first is, what we're proposing, that you deepen the water body and make it much larger, so that that water body then finally acts as a reservoir for this small plot. So that's the water body being expanded. The earth that came out of that water body will finally be used to construct the walls, which will all be adobe, and then bamboo screens with a bamboo roof on top and thatch. So almost all the material being used on this site is coming from within the site or just around the site. So that's the overall master plan, where the petrol pump on the left hand side is entered, and the car which just wants petrol or groceries can enter that portion and get out. Otherwise, if you need to stay a night for overnight travel, there are 5 rooms at the back, and the structure on the right hand side is a large restaurant which is open. All these spaces are naturally cooled. There's no air conditioning proposed anywhere. These are detailed plans of the petrol pump and the roof, the restaurant structure, with very large toilets for travelers. And then the 5 rooms right at the back, which are in this private zone overlooking the pond that you've created. Cross sections through the entire site. We show this huge undulating roof in bamboo. Each one of the curvatures was totally differently worked out based upon the space and the geometry. So only the petrol pump one has a steel supporting structure as well because it is a large span. And this roof is of double layered bamboo because we didn't want to use thatch in a petrol pump area. This is the restaurant structure. And that's the inside of the restaurant. And then these are the rooms towards the back. Completely sheltered. And you've taken the roof totally down so that it protects the adobe construction. And these are the rooms looking out now towards the pond area. So all of it built in just adobe, bamboo, thatch. And finally, a look back from the pond side looking towards the rooms. So all the orientation within this site is done towards the north. The north is towards the rear. This is a study on what different walls do to temperature. So we finally did have proposed a 450 mm adobe wall, which increases the heat reduction to the maximum. That's construction of adobe wall. So we looked at doing it in adobe bricks first, but then found that actual adobe construction is much better. And then how the roof is taken further down to reduce the sunlight that hits the adobe walls. And at the same time, it also protects from rain. So all of these features come together to make a completely contextual, sustainable design which is very pertinent to the villages of that area, because all these skills are available right there on site and around site. So this is a project we did in Mathura a year ago. It's a student's hostel which is 800 rooms, and in a 100-acre campus, this was a site given to us, a small wedge-shaped site which is shaped like a trapezoid. The images on the right show the existing hostel buildings. Now, when we started showing the kind of designs that we had done, it was a new client, first meeting. Before he'd even reached halfway point, he said, Mr. Sanjay, I've seen enough. All I want to know is, in 2 weeks, will you be able to give me drawings to start work on site? Because I have 6 months. More students are going to come into the college campus and I need accommodation for them. And for me, that is the only important thing. I need the building in 6 months. Can you give me construction drawings in 2 weeks? And of course, looking back at the kind of construction that they were doing earlier, it is obvious that none of these buildings need more than 3 days. I mean, you don't even need 2 weeks to design buildings like that. Now, all those hostels which they have actually constructed earlier are the typical railway barrack kind of rooms, central corridor, rooms on either side, and one block facing the other block, facing the other block, facing the other block at a distance of 5 meters, 6 meters, 5 meters, 6 meters. You got this massive playground, and even the hostel rooms around this playground don't look at that playground. They're looking into each other instead. It's really sad the way some of the stuff, you know, that gets done in this country. And here again, the client is not interested in design. The only thing was, he said, 2 weeks, I want construction drawings. Can you do it? We said, yes, we'll do it. So we looked at the numbers first. It was essential that it had to be done in ground plus 3, but that was the requirement. The entire campus is only ground plus 3 for two reasons. They wanted fast construction. They wanted lower cost construction. And they did not want the building obviously to be higher than everything else that was already constructed on this site. So that's the maths of it. That was the kind of built mass required on this plot. So rather than doing something that was typical like this, we decided to create a completely organic flow, like the organic streets of any old city in India, where when you're here, you don't necessarily see beyond a point. So you go to a point, the road turns. You go to a point, the road turns. There's always this interest, and it allows you and makes you want to go further and further, rather than looking down one straight spine and being able to see everything at one time. So that eventual configuration allows all these internal garden spaces to finally look out towards this large playground, which is used by all the students of this campus every evening. So then we started looking at the modules, because this had to be done extremely economically. And we were actually given the room size, said 9 feet by 11 feet is what we build. We cannot build larger than that, because if we build larger than that, then there'll be this whole thing about, you know, I got a small room and I got a big room. So this is the room size you have to work with now, you know, and common toilets. So those were the brief, you know, constraints given to us. So first we looked at how within these organic streets can you create rooms that actually all overlook that playground, because that playground to us was the main important factor in this whole campus. The playground firstly was on the northern side, and it would make complete sense to orient each one of these rooms towards the north and look out at the playground. But if you do that, the circulation space increases to almost 2 times, number one. And number two, then you have to give a kind of balcony space outside the hostel room, which we were categorically told no balconies, because students use balconies in very wrong ways. We don't want to give balconies. So we came up with this, that there was a central spine corridor with no wastage of space. And then every room gets this large bay window, which overlooks the north and overlooks those gardens. And then at each point, these streets actually turn within. There's this breakout space. So not only does the entire layout make these organic streets, within every building, there is an organic street that turns and turns at every point. So these buildings don't appear too long. That's the sun path diagram at different times of the day. And then there are these two large focal points in the entire campus. The whole site is 4 acres, which house the games room and the mess cafeteria and become the gathering points for the students. So this is the detail of how the spine gets broken at every short distance, and the detailed ground floor plan, and then the upper level plan. And this is what we did with the windows. So rather than making all of them repetitive, we twisted them. So some lean back, some lean forward. So if, when you have 800 rooms and 800 windows, this creates a very interesting rhythm and pattern, instead of it being something that was completely symmetrical and repetitive in nature. And then to give identity to each one of these hostels, because there is a huge loss of identity when you have something that is repeated on a large scale. And we don't want to start coloring all the buildings in different colors. So the color is given just within the bay window and the soffits. So primary colors, red, blue, and yellow, which distinguish one hostel block from the other, the cross sections, and the building as it is seen from the playground side. So each part you go in this campus, and because of the orientation, there is always a portion that is sheltered from the eastern sun or the western sun. So on the morning side, you can walk on this side, in the evening you walk on the other side, and there is a lot of sheltered space throughout the day in every part of this whole layout. In addition to that, you get all these interesting compositions when you move through. So it actually becomes organic in a very modern, abstract way. These are very large steps, purposely done to create an open auditorium which is sheltered, looking out towards the playground. And I'm happy to see students using this all the time. Every evening, this is full of students looking out, playing. Somebody was playing a guitar the day we went. That's the cafeteria and gym towards the rear, which becomes a focal point towards the rear. So one focal point towards the rear and one right in the front. So these are the distinguishing points within the layout. So at every point you go, you get this, you know, different composition of built space. We had very limited budget, as I said earlier. So the only thing that we've done is play with volume and color. And these buildings have been constructed at 1400 rupees a square foot, which is inclusive of the furniture which is within. That's the cafeteria. These are the interesting compositions which you get when you walk through. These are people who are sitting there at 3 o'clock in the afternoon in the month of May. I mean, just imagine. I mean, it's absolute fact. We were there, we were shooting this place and we were making a small video of it. 3 o'clock in the afternoon, enough shade to sit in the open when it was 36 or 37 degrees that day outside. It was very nice to go back to a place and see that the design actually works. And a lot of students also met me. And in fact, it was very interesting when one of the students said that, you know, we leave, you know, the entire campus and this has become our gathering point for everything. I mean, a 100-acre campus, everybody leaves it and comes to this small 4-acre portion every evening. So this is a view from right from the rear, looking out at these gardens and then finally looking out towards the main playground towards the northern side. And the orientation of all these windows towards the north. A huge amount of heat reduction by the way all these hostel rooms are oriented. In fact, one very interesting thing is that air conditioning piping and all of that had been laid and the air conditioning units which are ordered had not come in on time and the hostels were started. And hostels always start in the summer months. And the faculty was expecting a lot of flack and a lot of, you know, comments on how the rooms would be hot, and surprisingly they got none. And very interesting to note that that air conditioning order was finally cancelled and these rooms are not air conditioned anymore. It was almost about a 27% reduction in heat simply by the way the buildings are oriented within the site. Very interesting to see students using those bay windows the way they were intended. So that was the street, and this is a proposal we made for a small site in Jaipur for the Shiva Museum. If you travel in Jaipur anywhere by car or a bike, the chances are that every 10 minutes you will pass one of these buildings. I mean, it's not a joke. For all of you who've been to Jaipur, 10 minutes, 12 minutes maximum, you would pass one of these buildings. Rajasthan is culturally the most rich part in India in terms of architectural heritage. And then, unfortunately, the last 10 years, this is what is being built in Rajasthan. I don't know why somebody would make wraparound glass buildings in temperatures exceeding 40 degrees Celsius for 8 months of the year. So this is our site. It's a really, really small site, but very interestingly located, looking out at this beautiful lake once you go slightly higher. And there's an existing old temple behind the site. So the first thing we did was study the site in terms of traffic pattern to see where people are coming from. And very interestingly, you know, in India, everybody's used to taking these shortcuts. So that red line there, I don't know if there's a pointer here, is the shortcut which people take. So the actual entry to the temple is from the left-hand side. The temple which is behind our site is from the left-hand side, where also you see a lot of people entering from. But most people are entering, walking through the site and going into the side entrance of the temple. So that's the temple at the back. So we looked at the site and the amount of built up area that was required, 80,000 square feet. And there is a height restriction. So when you build a volume of that size, this is what it would do. It would completely hide this temple from the view of the road, the main road that passes it. So one of the first things we thought is, what happens if we split this building into two parts? It's 80,000 square feet as the client's requirements, but we can split it into two parts. By doing this split, you allow that main dome on this side of the temple to be visible from the main road still. And at the same time, you create this whole kind of public access to it. So people can still go through, but now they will be walking through the museum space, through an open space to reach the rear side. And then that becomes the section where the person on the main road can still see the top of the temple through this, through the museum building. And then this is interestingly done with a screen wall, and it is completely open with natural ventilation and natural daylight through it. So the idea was that these steps also act like a small open auditorium kind of space. And then the rooftop is created as a landscape terrace, which will overlook the lake on the right hand side. So this is also in a way acts like the courtyards that are prevalent in Indian architecture. This is the main building basement with cores on the periphery, so that the entire rest of the space is column free and has complete flexibility upon how it can be used. And as it goes up, you have these little bridges connecting one side to the other side. So that again is an interesting thing. I don't know how many times I've been to a museum, all of you have been to museums, and you find that you go to a museum building, whether it's 20,000-30,000 square feet or it's 100,000 square feet, depending on how big it is, you come into an entrance point and you keep going in first floor, second floor, third floor, fourth floor, whatever it is, and then you come out. So it's almost about 4-5 hours before you've actually seen sunlight or been in the open. You're always within a controlled atmosphere. So we purposely made this whole circuit where one goes into one part of the building and there is an exhibit there. Then you walk through this open space to the other side. Then you complete that part, and the way the circulation leads you, you go back from a bridge to the next floor. So it becomes interesting. So you go enclosed space, open space, enclosed space, open space. So that whole transition, we think, will make it much more interesting. Towards the southern side on the terrace, there are solar paneling, and the right side is completely landscaped. These are the floor plans, ground floor plan, and then as you go up, the other level. So we actually did the whole division also. It's a Shiva museum. Shiva has 108 names. So the first pavilion is only the 108 names. Second is the significance and the story of Shiva, and so on as you go up the floors, with each part telling you something different, a different aspect. And then the rooftop, which is a complete landscape garden overlooking the lake, which can be used by the public even if they don't want to see the museum. So that's a detailed cross section showing complete cross ventilation through the main spine. And the pathway that leads to the temple from the main road towards the rear. So that's the way the building is seen from the main road, with the outline taken actually from Shiva's most famous pose. So you actually, when you walk in through slowly and you see these bridges and all the stonework on either side, and then you see that temple dome when you reach the top and a clear view of it. So these are the steps that would act like an open auditorium. And again, there is a different Shiva image towards the rear, which kind of frames the temple dome at the back. So all of this was done taking these images and then putting them together like this to create this whole path. So a lot of people, when they saw this design for the first time, thought it was some kind of parametric design that was done, but it's not that. So we actually took this pose and that pose and then tried to merge the two, and that's the shape that came about. And that's the whole transition that you feel when you walk through the open spaces of the museum. These are the internal volumes. And that's the terrace on the top from which you can see the lake. So the entire building is proposed to be built in Chittorgarh stone, which is locally available in Rajasthan. Most of those open spaces are all cross ventilated and naturally ventilated. The jali screens on all sides to reduce the amount of heat gain from wherever we are taking natural light. And all of this is being done in stone, giving the stone artisans who are now out of work in a lot of parts in India, especially in Rajasthan, because of the advent of GRC and GFRC and bison board panels and so many other panels and CNC cutting, which has made life very simple for everyone. But these guys have lost their jobs. So we actually want to build this back actually in real stone. So that was the Shiva Museum. And this is a university that we have just started in Indore called Prestige. So this is our site. There is a new ring road around Indore, which connects the airport to the main city as well. And that first portion is our site, with the second portion right now being acquired by the clients for future expansion. So the entry, as you can see, is through this very narrow mouth towards the northeast. Now, looking at the amount of area that they needed to be built, which is 200,000 square feet, we just looked at how one would build 200,000 square feet. So that's the kind of mass and volume that you would have on this site to build 200,000 square feet, 8 floors of a big, huge structure. But then it's a university, you don't want to build 8 floors. So we said, let's try a plinth area, which is larger, and build only 4 floors. Then what happens? But when you do this, you get this really large floor plate. Of course, the landscape area gets reduced to 48% from 60 earlier. But what happens to the light penetration when you do a plinth of that size? We all know that light penetration only from 7.5 to 9 meters. So the entire central portion would have no natural light if one was to do a plinth of this size. So the next thing to do is cut it and make a courtyard. When you cut it and make a courtyard, you double that thing because it's 7.5 from here, 7.5 from there. And then what happens? The building expands still more and the landscape is reduced to 39%. But courtyards, you know, have been done and have been done and have been done again, which is a good thing. But what happens in a courtyard in a large building is that when you, either you're in this classroom or that classroom or that classroom or that auditorium, when you walk out into the corridor, it's always the same. You're looking down at the same corridor, only thing the angle might be slightly different. How do you create something that is unique here? Every space should have its own identity. So we said, let's not do one courtyard, you do a series of courtyards because it's a large building, it's 200,000 square feet. Puncture it in various places and get natural light in interesting ways, and thereby you give this interesting feel to each one of these spaces. And then, rather than just working on this straight kind of grid that always happens, let's change that also. So that is broken diagonally, and there was a reason for doing this, because this land is going to come in very soon, and that is going to house the next set of classrooms that this university will build. So this creates this whole organic path which goes through this building and then finally reaches the other one. Of course, there will be vehicle access separate, but in a college, there's always students walking from one place to the other place. So this is to facilitate that. So that whole central spine becomes organic, connecting the back building. And from that, you enter all these classrooms. So slowly, what happened when we kept doing this is that that landscape, which was very high when we built an 8-story structure, went down, and became finally like 30% only. So we said, this is not okay, you know, because 30% landscape is not enough. So let's do something. Let's take the back portion slightly higher, the front portion slightly lower, and let this landscape go onto the roof of the building. So you virtually make 100% of the site landscape. And there are two things that happen with this. It's not just the garden climbing up. Everybody is going to approach this site only from the northeast because that is the only choice. There is no other entry point available. So every university we go to, you come to a university and you see this massive building in front of you. Even ground plus 3 is pretty massive when you see that kind of scale, because the building itself is some 200, 300 feet long. So this way, the perception becomes it's really small. And as you keep driving in, or you keep walking in, or you keep cycling in, the building slowly goes up. So you get this whole interesting thing of how the entire building is stepped with the garden climbing up, and people can start using this entire roof. In a way, it conveys what a stepwell had, the ancient stepwells of India, and allows people to use the whole terrace in the evenings. And then to further reduce the heat gain, We've created jali panels on all four sides because those sides face east, south, west, where there is harsh sunlight at some point of the day. So that reduces heat gain. And these are the floor plans stacking up one by one as you progress to the next level, the second floor and the third floor. It was a very complex program with number of classrooms of different sizes, an auditorium, a huge library, admin areas, offices, which of course is the case in most colleges and universities, but generally these buildings are spread apart and are separate. But in this case, everything had to be built within this one plot, because right now this is the only land that they have, and eventually they will have more land after this. So we all know that in architecture, the section is, I think, the most important drawing, because it is the section that gives you the actual perception of space. Now just see what happens when you walk through this. The section is constantly changing. The volumes are constantly changing. Somewhere you're in 24 feet height, somewhere you're in 36 height, somewhere you're in 12 feet height, and somewhere you're in heights which are split. Somewhere natural light is coming in from the left, somewhere is coming in from the right. So these sections are constantly changing, and they themselves create this very interesting graphic composition as you walk through. The volumes are constantly changing. So these are the floor plans as they stack up with the landscape also continuing at the same time, level by level, until you reach the top floor, which are the admin offices. And as I said earlier, 100% of the site now becomes landscaped virtually, except for that little area that went in the road. And this is a cross section showing how natural light comes in through different courtyards of different sizes in different parts of the entire university. So that's the way the building will be perceived in an aerial view. And the actual front when you see it, so it doesn't really look like a large building because it's been fragmented into these small blocks as it goes further. Views from the terrace looking down. So there's a board here, so that's saying time up. And you have 5 more minutes only. So everywhere the composition of space is totally different. The way light will come in is totally different. So we hope that this will be a really interesting kind of space for students to use. And this is the last project. This is a house that we recently did. Me and my wife, Nina, did this together in Lucknow. It's an 8,500 square feet house, not very large, in Lucknow city. That's a site. So this is Gomti Nagar in Lucknow, which is the newer area of Lucknow, which has all small and large villas in this entire area. So for our site, all these plots, actually most of them are slightly small in nature, but this client has bought 4 plots together and clubbed them, as a result of which he's actually got roads on all 4 sides. But the important thing is that the main road from which you enter is actually an arterial road of the city with very high traffic, and that's what actually drove the design in a number of ways. So this is the site, and ordinarily what one would have done is create the building towards the rear. Where the main road is, you have a large garden space from where you enter, but then it would mean that the garden becomes south facing, which means it is not usable for a lot of times of the day. Also, the garden becomes a place where you would not be able to sit because the kind of traffic on this road, it's a very busy road through most parts of the day. So what we've done is moved the building towards the road and created the garden on the northern side, which is the quieter side. And this is the building block that emerges based on the requirements of the client, which are 5 bedrooms, a small gym, a study, puja room, etc. And here we've looked at the traditional Indian courtyard, but again, looked at it in a slightly different way. You know, normally what one does is, in the olden houses, there was a block, the corridor running around the courtyard, and then the similar block on top. So basically, it was one shape which was then divided into different rooms based on the requirement. Here what we've done is, based on the requirement, every room is given a different volume and then it's interspersed around this courtyard, which allows cross ventilation through 2 cuts within it. And then the above level is again separately done. So it's not the typical courtyard where you just have a courtyard which is cut in and rooms divided. Each room is an individual identity within this which is surrounding the courtyard. And then it's got all these interstitial spaces which have all filled with green. And stepping back towards the northern side, looking out towards the garden. And then, because there was a road on the southern side, there are screens that are used to shield the house for two reasons. One is to reduce the heat gain into the building, and the second to reduce the sound. And the third is to give privacy from the main road. So this is the detailed floor plan. So very interesting spaces within this house. I mean, people today in India are making houses to, you know, 25,000 and 30,000 square feet. So in relation to that, this is a small house. It's 8,500 square feet. But then again, most bungalows are in the range of 2,500, 3,000. So then that's big. So it's, I don't know what to call this, a large house or a small house. It's a middle-sized house. So those are the floor plans, the solar panels on the top, skylights for the courtyard space. Because it's not an open courtyard. It's a courtyard which is open on all 4 sides, but it's sheltered on the top so that it's protected from the rain. But at the same time, it allows cross ventilation, it allows hot air to go out and keeps the entire structure naturally cool. So these are views from the south side and from the main road side. And then one actually enters from the east, and this is the garden on the northern side. So the north is the only side that is completely open. The east, west and south all are screened purposely. So the house then becomes fragmented into this series of cuboids. It's completely done in exposed concrete and GRC panels, and plants in between the screen and the main windows act as a further buffer, reducing the noise from the main roads. That's the central courtyard space. The interior is very, very simple. All predominantly one color walnut wood along with the concrete. And very interesting shadows and light at different times of the day in different parts of the house. So I'll end with this small video of this house. Thank you. Thank you very much for your attention. Thank you, Foyed. Thank you, Shraddha. Thank you, the entire team.